Inspired by the life of the savvy and ambitious Colombian businesswoman Griselda Blanco, comes a new Netflix original limited series. Griselda tells the story of a devoted mother who, with her lethal blend of charm and relentless savagery, creates one of the most powerful cartels in history. Witness Sofia Vergara's captivating transformation into the godmother of the underworld. Griselda, now streaming only on Netflix.
Join me, 48 Hours correspondent Erin Moriarty, on my podcast, My Life of Crime, as I take on true crime investigations like no other. This season, I'm looking into the labyrinth of crime and secrets within families. I'm cutting straight to the evidence and talking to the people directly involved, including investigators and the families of victims. Listen to My Life of Crime with Erin Moriarty wherever you get your podcasts.
Bernigan, ABCs.
Welcome to the Bernigan ABCs, where I think I must have done something oppressive to the rest of my co-hosts because they have said fight the power and have abandoned me for the week. But no worries. I'm sure that I'll get back into the good graces, you know, in a week or two. But in the meantime, I am ecstatic to say that I have with me this week, Saker, from It's All Been Done podcast.
How's it going, man?
It's going pretty great. I'm glad to have you on.
Yeah, I understand. You lose your co-host, you have to poach from the other BNL podcast. That's rough, dude. You didn't tell me that coming in.
I didn't know that coming in.
It's weirdly,
just been a slow attrition throughout the week.
Erin and Evan now have a podcast that they're doing, which is very strange to me. I think they abandoned us for their own.
Is that what they've done?
That's the scuttlebutt. That's the word on the street. Yes.
Then I gotta figure out where Michelle's gone off to again. I hope that Weird Al pod has not stolen her again. I thought we had that all like patched up and taken care of. I'm gonna have to give them a write.
Oh, are you guys, and you guys are head-to-head with the Weird Al podcast. They are your sworn enemies, correct?
Oh, they were. I thought we were okay, but
sure.
Maybe not.
I gotta say, that's a little bit hurtful to me, because as we say every week on our podcast, we hate you guys, and you are our sworn enemy. So for it not to be mutual makes me very sad. I mean, it doesn't make me a happy man.
Well, it's like that whole thing from Batman.
You think you're my greatest enemy?
Yes, you're obsessed with us.
No, we're not.
Yes, you are.
No, we're not.
Yes, you are. Who else drives you to one-up in the way that we do?
Alphabetical.
No, they don't. They aren't even around anymore.
The Adventure Zone podcast.
Nuh-uh. They don't even cover music.
Weird Alphabet.
Okay, Weird Alphabet aren't bad guys.
Then I'd say we don't currently have a nemesis. We are fighting with a few different people.
What?
We like to fight around.
Okay, look, I'm fine with you fighting other people if you want to do that, but what we have here is special. So when people ask you, who's your number one bad guy, you say...
This might be a podcast.
Are you seriously saying that there's nothing special about our relationship?
Whoa, let me tell you something. IAPD, Bare Naked ABCs, doesn't do ships.
What?
Yeah. Even, I don't know what I meant there. I suppose you are our greatest rivals, even though there is room for everyone in this world. Okay, enough of the movie quotes.
So are you setting yourself up as the Batman of the trivial bands that people Ooh. Sort of care about now universe?
I like it. Although I have to admit, I'm probably more the Green Lantern than I am Batman.
Okay, all right. I guess that makes us like... Parallax or Zalarap or some dumb bullshit. We came shortly after you and are like a bizarro version of you.
Well, maybe you could be Sinestro. That's better.
There we go. That Sinestro's makes a lot more sense.
A much and better not, version.
Yeah, not as deep of a pool as Zalarap, so I think people will probably latch onto that quicker too. So good call as usual. You win. Is that what you want to hear? You win.
No, because I have to admit, I'm and being as much of a geek, I'm like, yeah, I actually know all those references.
Oh yeah, I'm sure you. Listen. As we talk about, again, on my dumb podcast all the time, you have to, if you're a fan of the Bare Naked Ladies, you are a huge geek. You were ostracized in high school, and that's what turned you towards the dark side of 1 week. And now you are where you are today in your IT job or on your Twitch streams or whatever it is the hell you do.
By the way, your guest that you had last week that was talking about the geek theory around Bare Naked Ladies, absolutely loved that discussion.
Oh, sure. Cap is, again, when I was talking, Cap and Evan were talking over my head 90% of the time. She is very, very smart. It was a delight to have her.
So you guys are halfway through Maroon now.
Oh my God, we are. And it is horrible to look into. Listen, I love Bare Naked Ladies, but I know right now we're on the top of the hill. Like, I can look above me or beyond me, and I can see what's coming, and I dread the post-Blam era. But, you know, we've made a choice, we've made a decision, it is what it is, but I am loving Maroon right now. It is such a joy.
No, it's, I think, one of the better albums out there, so I'm really glad that you guys are on that one right now.
Yeah. I always say it's my favorite, and I haven't given it a proper listen in a really long time. So now that we're going through it again, I was nervous. I was wondering if I was viewing it through rose-colored glasses, like, maybe this is gonna... But no, so far it is just as wonderful as I remember it being, so I'm pleased with it.
Yeah, see, I don't get to figure that out until the very end of the podcast, how that's all gonna end up wrapping up for us.
Yeah,
that's
for real.
The benefits of the way that you guys are going about this. The end of an album, you're like, yeah, I really enjoyed this as much as I thought I would.
Do you guys do that?
We have to hit like the whys.
Yes. Well, at the end of every letter, I think you guys should pretend like that was an album, like the A album. How was that album? Like, oh, that album sucked ass. It didn't make any sense. The Numbers album was two songs long. That album fucking sucks.
Now, see, that's what I love about your podcast. You have all these wonderful, great ideas. I wish I was as witty as that to come up with that kind of stuff.
Well, you
that's
can
why I
it.
Just do it the ABC way, because I'm like, it's easy, it's cut and dry, I don't have to be witty.
Sure. But you all are. It's such a good podcast. We truly love you guys. I'm looking at the tracklist thing for Maroon right now, just to kind of refresh myself where it falls in the alphabet. We have a lot of late. We have Too Little Too Late, Pinch Me, Sell, Tonight Is the Night I Fell Asleep at the Wheel. You guys, that's like way further than you are right now, right? You won't be hitting the hits until way later.
Oh, much, much, much later. We just hit Falling for the first time.
I gotta tell you, it's a delight. The first time when you invited me on for Born Human, you shared with me a Excel document that you had made that listed like, well, we're going to be doing Pinch Me on February 2nd, 2021. And we're going, like, you listed every single song and the date you would be doing it, which is the most optimistic thing I've ever seen in my life.
It is totally optimistic. And I have to say, it was really super easy because all I had to do was get it to add a week on each layer.
Oh, yeah. Well, that makes a lot of sense, actually.
I haven't even looked that far ahead because it's actually kind of depressing to sit there and go, we'll be done with this podcast in, 23. 2023.
Sure.
Oh,
sure.
God.
Yeah, that's what Ev says to me all the time. The other day, he just messaged me. He's like, hey, we're almost through Maroon. That's like almost done, right? And I was like, oh, my sweet summer child. No, you got a long way to go, buddy. We're on album 5 out of 12.
Exactly. It feels like it's like you're on the nice, easy part of it.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, my God. When we are in All in Good Time and Grinning Streak, I will be ripping my teeth out live on air. It's going to be some great epos. Going to be good content.
You're going to have to get video of that, though.
Oh, sure. We'll be doing video casts for those eps, yeah. How do we get you on an episode? Because here's the problem. You can have me on for B-sides because we'll never cover them. We can never, literally never have you on an episode because you're going to do every single one, right?
Well, I can always come on. Maybe one that I've already covered.
Okay, all right, that makes sense. So, yeah.
And there's plenty of them.
Yeah, okay, that's true.
We're on episode 79. We're plugging along. Now,
you really are, I'm impressed.
Yeah, now, of course, there's 284 as of right now, unless they release more.
Sure. Sure. Well, If we're really getting into the weeds on where we are, I'm looking right now, we're on episode 64, but that also includes, like, the episode where we talk about Fraggle Rock for the entire episode and Not Bare Naked Ladies, and the episode where we, you know, just talk about an interview with Paul Meyer. So we have a lot of, like, dumb bullshit in ours. So, yeah. We're both making it work, though. We're making it work.
You are, and I have to say, one of my favorite episodes, my favorite episode was... Tiny little song. I'll say it is. I always mess this one up.
And you call yourselves the fans. Yeah, yeah.
I was telling them last week. I was like, I can never get the name of that song right. And it's the shortest song.
Yeah, because it's in the wrong order. Yeah, Canadians are insane. Yeah, and Straw Hat and Old Dirty Hank, not Dirty Old Hank. Yeah, their adjective order, as I've said before, is insane.
Very odd. But my favorite episode is Tiny Little Song, because...
play D&D.
Where you guys play D&D as Bare Naked Ladies characters. I was laughing the whole
That's
episode.
Right. I'm so glad you like that one. That was the most work I've ever done, because we had to, like, go into the studio where the Cryptonaturalist, our good friend Jared Anderson, he is an actual professional podcaster who does a good podcast that many people enjoy. So he was going to be one of the characters. We went to his studio. I made sure I scrounged up enough mics, and then we recorded it. And then, you know, the nightmare scenario happened where he said, only one of the mics actually picked anything up after we had tested it a million times. So we ended up having to scrape that one together, but I'm glad you enjoyed it. It's not one I recommend people listen to, but I'm glad you enjoy
the audio quality. Yeah, you know, we all have our episodes where it does that. Sure. I can guarantee we have definitely had those. The product that was in there was amazing and hilarious. So,
thank you.
Now I think what we need to do is we need to convince someone that's in the computer graphics design world to go out and do a Mortal Kombat version, but with Bare Naked Ladies characters.
Oh my goodness, that sounds like a dream. I'd be into that.
I would buy that, and I would probably end up, like, taking so much time off for work, I would lose my job.
But is there just 6 playable characters, or do you have unlockables, like, you could play as Gordon, and you can play as,
Dirty Old Hank?
Oh, Dirty Old Hank. Oh, man. Yeah, absolutely. Oh my gosh, there's so many options. Actually, we've considered, for a while, Born on a Pirate Ship, we ran out of questions, and so I had made this, which is, of course, people can only ask, like, which ice cream flavor are each of the Bare Naked Ladies enough times, where they ran out of stupid shit to ask us, but, so I made a bracket of a bunch of different Bare Naked Ladies narrators, and I had a bunch of different, like, things that they would do. So it would be, like, the narrator of some fantastic versus the narrator of just a toy in a cooking contest. Who would win? Then we'd talk it out, and they would move on to the next bracket. And then a freestyle rap battle with the same thing narrator versus the I know narrator. Like, but we thankfully got more questions so that people weren't subjected to that.
Well, I also love the wheel that you guys do. Like, you guys are great in terms of coming up with ideas. It's a lot of fun to listen to you.
Aw, thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me onto your mutual masturbation podcast, where we just say how much we like each other the whole time. That's my favorite.
I was just going to say the same thing. We are talking about The Wizard of Wonderland today. Now, today we will be talking about another B-side that is not on any of the albums that you guys will cover, I'm guessing.
Correct.
By the way, are you guys...
We will not be covering the Coneheads soundtrack.
And you don't have to give it away here. I'm interested to find out whether or not you guys will be covering Hidden Sun when it comes down to the end of this album.
So when it comes down to it, I am kind of the final arbiter of what we cover and what we don't cover. And Hidden Sun for me was always a canonical part of Maroon. So yes, we will be covering Hidden Sun when we get down to
it's going to be fun to listen to that.
I'm excited. Oh yeah. Kevin's first, big day in town.
Unfortunately, I don't get to listen to like a third of what you guys have recorded so far. Cause I always wait till after we're done before I listen to it.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that's a bummer.
So this week we're going to be listening to a song that's not a Bare Naked Ladies song, but it is a Bare Naked Ladies song. It's them covering Fight the Power in their own interesting way a number of times.
1989, the number, another summer.
Get down!
Sound of the funky drummer. Music hitting your heart because I know you got soul.
Rhythms and system.
So originally the song was written by Carlton Ridenhour, better known as Chuck D, for Public Enemy. They were. It's also given credit to Eric Sadler, Hank Shockley, and Keith Shockley. Interestingly enough, it's not given any credit to Flava Flav, who gives all the Flava in the background. But
he's not called Flava D or Flava Sadler.
Exactly. There's three major canonical areas that you can find this song. It was a big part of their early days history. So this is what they used to play when they're out doing gigs all the time. Not quite sure why. I'm guessing Ed was the big rap person. But it's interesting to hear him, the influences that he's had in his life. You have rap on one side, mm-hmm. country mm-hmm. on the other. So you can find this on the Yellow Tape. You can find this on the Coneheads soundtrack. And you can find this on a recent CD, which I've only been able to get through Amazon.com. Amazon.com, if you want to give us any credit, please send us money. But they sell this CD called Hello City Live from Toronto in 1991, although they didn't release it until 2017. And it is from June 15th, 1991 concert in Toronto. I believe it was at the Horseshoe, which is one of the places they frequented quite mm-hmm. a bit. It's also the place where Ed and Steve first got on stage and played with Andy and Jim. So,
oh, okay. So this is a historic Barenaked Ladies landmark.
Right.
Okay.
So it wasn't that date that happened, but it was, sure. Yeah, that was one of the historic landmarks for them.
Wait, all four of them didn't get up on stage and start playing music together and fight the power immediately? That amazes me.
I would have loved to have seen that.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
They probably all could have pulled that off.
I don't doubt it. They are all consummate musicians.
Because from the way the story goes, when I was reading the book that you had talked about, that you talked to the author about, Paul Myers, they actually did that. Like, Ed and Steve were touring, and then, like, they came home. They were doing some concerts between the tour, the two breaks of the tour, and they were playing at the Horseshoe, and they invited Andy and Jim just to come up on stage, and they just started jamming right there on stage.
Yeah, that's such an incredible story. Yeah, it's like, I amazing. Mean, yeah, attest to, you know, how incredible they are.
There's no... Here's the interesting thing. So they cover this song, but none of the versions where they cover this song, do they cover all the lyrics?
Yeah, I think the Coneheads version gets pretty close, right?
Right.
Yeah.
That's the closest they get.
What are they missing in that one? Maybe I just missed...
Now you're asking me something I didn't research.
Okay. I mean, they do change
I
it
sat
up.
There reading all the lyrics and going down through it, but I didn't highlight, like, oh, here's this
sure,
one.
Sure.
And here's, 'cause just 'cause there was too many versions.
Sure. Well, they change it up, especially the third verse where, you know, Elvis was a hero to most, Buddy, and then they riff on Buddy for a while instead of Buddy Never Meant Shit to Me. They do their little, yeah, Buddy Elvis or Buddy Epson, Buddy Rich. And beyond that, I feel like it was pretty similar, right? I think so.
Yes.
Yeah.
They kept pretty close to it. The biggest change was the intro on Hello City Live from Toronto.
Well, burn, Hollywood, burn. I smell a riot going on. First you're guilty, now you're gone. Yeah, I'll check out a movie. It'll take a black one to move me. Give me the hell away from this TV. All these news and views are beneath me. All right, fellas, I don't know any more words.
And on that one, I had to write down the lyrics because you can't actually find them anywhere. So I spent a good 15 minutes in there and trying to decipher all that. It must have been a really hot temperature in the club that night, or something was going on with fire, because they kept making these reactions with the other songs or in between songs to fire and how hot it was. And it actually says just before the song, if there's any newspaper reporters in the audience, I think the quote for the paper tomorrow is Barenaked Ladies fans would rather burn than leave the concert early. And then you got Steve in the background goes, oh no, here comes Kurt Russell, a reference to Backdraft.
Sure, yes. Well, and then at the beginning of the song, they do, of course, the Burn Hollywood Burn part from Public Enemy's Burn Hollywood Burn, the song Burn Hollywood Burn.
Is that what that is from? Okay, I have to admit, I don't know rap well enough.
Yeah, so yeah, they do, it's okay, they do Public Enemy's Burn Hollywood Burn, which is another Public Enemy song, and then they kind of call backs, because instead of fight the power in the middle, they start saying fight the fire.
Right.
For Burn Hollywood, yeah. So,
I spent an hour this week going back and going, wait, this is 1991, were they referencing the LA riots? Like, is that what was going on here? That's not right, because that didn't happen for another year.
Yeah. I don't know specifically what Burn Hollywood Burn is referencing, but because that's a song where I am not as familiar with it. I think it's just how, like, Hollywood portrays black people, or how they did portray them in the late 80s, early 90s. So, yeah, 1990, that song was released. So, again, and this is going to kind of feed into what I'm talking about. But, yeah, that's kind of the hook of that song.
Oh, I'm glad that you knew, because I was baffled and, like, yeah, got myself down this really weird rabbit hole for hours.
Right. Right.
Going back and reliving my high school days in the riots.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, that.
So I don't have to cover any of that. I'm glad. Yeah.
That live version, the speed at which they're playing it is unreal. They are, like, hyperspeed that song for some reason.
They are. This song, in any version that they play it in, but especially in the live version,
yeah,
they are going so fast.
Yeah.
That Ed's actually tripping over his words at times, like, because he's going so fast. Well,
and I wonder what they were doing. Like, I wonder if they were just trying to flex, like, look how fast we can do this song, or if they, like, were I don't think they were embarrassed to do it, but maybe they were. Because, I mean, as a band, you practice, and then you go, oh, that's a comfortable speed where I can sing to it. But clearly, yeah, because Ed is kind of tripping over it from time to time. So it was bizarre to me that they were, it's cool, it's great to hear Ty just killing it on drums on the speed for that song.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
But yeah, it's very weird that that they all didn't feel super comfortable with it.
Well, I think it was just like that. What they do when they got in front of audiences at that time, mm-hmm, in their career. I think it also had a lot to do with Tyler. I think Tyler really pushed a lot of stuff back, mm-hmm, then. And he had just come into the group a year earlier, I want to say. And they were new to having him kind of lead things at that point, because Andy had been leading a lot of the beats at that point.
Sure.
So I'm wondering if that might have been part of it, because Ty admits that he likes to kind of just jazz up the beat and really go at it and really drive it, especially live.
Right.
Because if you listen to the rest of that live album and any of their earlier live stuff from that era, they are just going super speed. They're going like 1.5 speed on the podcast.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But it's also a lot of fun to listen to them at that speed.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. I mean, always entertaining. And just to see what they can do with the talents that they have is incredible, even if, it's not the same all the way around. Even if the singer can't quite keep up with it, it's still interesting musically to hear what's going on there.
Oh, yeah. You may know more about Public Enemy than I do. I don't know. I'm going to go off on a little bit of a divergence here for a second in case the audience doesn't know very much about Public Enemy.
Sure.
So, and you can fill in anything that you know, because I will admit I know nothing about Public Enemy. I did not listen, except for this song, to any,
yeah,
Public Enemy in high school.
I mean, I gotta say, I'm not
being
super
a white boy from Maine, like, it just didn't jive with me.
Sure, sure. And I was born in 85, so really their heyday was when I was a kid. And I love rap, but I never really went back, and which is crazy, because I should, you know, if I'm into rap, which I am, I should listen to the formative, you know, how it kind of got started and how it grew into the mainstream. But I just never really went back and listened to the Public Enemy and stuff from that era. So I'm not super familiar with them either.
All right. So I'll try to make this conversational, but I also will try to just drop some information.
Perfect.
Here and then.
Perfect.
We'll move on to the Bare Naked Ladies part of it.
Okay.
So a lot of this I'm getting from different sources on the web, one of which, of course, is Wikipedia, so just because it's the easiest and quickest to go to. Public Enemy's original version of this song was originally commissioned for Spike Lee's feature film Do the Right Thing. It was going to serve as the reoccurring musical motif for that film.
Mm-hmm.
They had just come off their second tour and were about to go on another tour with Run DMC, and Spike Lee, like, he wanted the film to be defiant and angry, and he wanted the song to be very rhythmic. So he immediately thought of Public Enemy and approached them and asked them before they went on tour, and they said yes. So while they were flying over Italy on tour, Chuck D wrote most of it. He wanted it to have a similar theme to the Isley Brothers' Fight the Power, which is a very interesting song as well, but not related to this other than just in title. I try to play my music, say my music's too loud. I try talking about it, I got is a song, as I'm talking more to the audience than you specifically say.
Good. But that sounded very confrontational already. I was concerned.
I am ready to come right at. If people are thinking that this is a song about fighting authority, they're wrong. It's never been about fighting authority. And I've never thought of it that way either, but I finally found confirmation when I was looking online. The bass player has come out and said basically the song is about law enforcement is necessary, and as a species, we haven't evolved past that. But fighting the power is not about fighting authority. It's about fighting the abuse of power.
Huh. Interesting, because I hadn't read that quote, and that kind of changes my read of the song a little bit. Because I thought specifically the third verse, where it talks about how, you know, Elvis, you know, is a hero to people, but fuck him because he's a racist piece of shit, and John Wayne is a piece of shit because I'm black and I'm proud. Like, it very, to me, it very much spoke to the message of, like, you know, our icons that we have are, you know, not giving the right message to society, and, you know, most of my heroes don't appear on no stamps. It really felt like an empowerment, a black power song. And boy, are we two cis white guys talking about black power on a Bare Naked Ladies podcast, which seems to be the exact correct place to do it. Him saying that kind of flips it on its head a little bit to me, and I wonder how much of that is him trying to kind of. I don't know if he's trying to soften the image of it, or he said it in 2015, apparently. Now I'm reading the same article that you are. So I wonder if Public Enemy was a lot angrier of a band in 1990 than they were in 2015, or what the deal is. But I'm curious. Yeah.
Possibly. So Chuck D actually talked specifically about that line that where he's targeting Elvis.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, like, white culture has hailed Elvis as king without acknowledging any of the black artists that came before him that he was very much built upon.
For sure.
And so, yeah, I kind of get his point. Like, yeah, Elvis is a hero to most of us, but, it, you know, what about all those people that he kind of stole from and stood on the shoulders of? And, you know, that makes total sense, like, why he would say that.
Yeah, so I guess that's hard for me to look into the idea of, like, fighting an abuse of power. I guess maybe fight the abuse of power, we love cops, is a harder thing to get into a song than fight the power, but I don't know.
Right.
I feel like this is a hard... I mean, hey, I am not undercutting what Brian Hardgroove, which is the best last name in the history of last names,
yes,
says about the message of this song. because he, I mean, he and his band wrote it, but that strikes me as very strange.
Well, and it was a very different time. Well, actually, not that different than today.
Right.
Things were kind of boiling over at that time in L.A. as well, and also in New York with what was going on then, very much what's going on now, very sadly, with police abusing their right to take care of, which then boiled to a year later, to the top with the Rodney King trial.
Mm-hmm.
But it had already been going on for months before that, which is why they had... You know, now I'm not going to remember the name of the band, so I'm messed up, but I remember it has Ice Cube in it. I'm freezing on it, and I know it, and people are yelling at me through their radios right now.
Yeah.
And through their earphones. I can't hear you.
NWA. Yeah.
NWA. Thank you. Yes. With Fuck the Police. The John Wayne one was a much more pointed statement. And
yeah.
I think that he kind of had it coming. Because, so that one was disparaging John Wayne because of his interview with Playboy, where he came out and he said, I believe in white supremacy until the blacks are educated to a point of responsibility. I don't believe in giving authority and positions of leadership and judgment to irresponsible people. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, unreal. And these, I mean... The message is pretty clear, is that these are who the media hails as heroes, which is a very, very similar thematic song to Burn Hollywood Burn, which is kind of on the same album too, Fear of a Black Planet.
So it was actually a super popular song, released originally on Motown Records, became a number one hit on the rap charts, on the new recording charts, big, huge number one hit for them. And then, of course, Spike Lee then produced and directed two music videos for this song. I'm not sure why he did two, but he did two. It's been covered three times. I think it's probably been covered more than that, but I can only find three covers of this. So one was done by DC a band I can't say. Uh-huh. DCK for the electro-industrial compilation of Operation Beatbox back in 1996.
1989, the number, another summer. Yeah, yeah. Sound of the funky drummer, music in your heart, cause I know you got soul.
I listened to that and that wasn't that bad. And then in 2011, Dillinger Escape Plan covered the song with Chuck D on the album.
Oh, Chuck D's on the song.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. That's interesting.
Yeah, it was kind of neat. I was like, oh, thank God the Bare Naked Ladies did this version.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. So that's all the background about this song from Public Enemy version.
Sure.
Let's talk about the Bare Naked Ladies version. Let's go to the Yellow Tape first.
Okay.
I don't want to keep coming across as the smarty pants here, so I'm going to let I'll let you kind of start with what you know about the Yellow Tape, and then I'll supplant anything I know in here as well.
About the album itself?
About the album and about this version on the album. I don't know.
Oh,
and
Tracy.
Then if not, I can always cut this out and see.
No, of course. You're more than welcome to keep it in, but you know full well that we are the Know Nothing podcast. It came out in 1991, and it was yellow. It had five or six songs on it. Is that correct?
It had five. It did.
Nailed it.
This was last one.
Okay, yeah, and that explains why it's so short, right? They're just filling time with it?
Exactly. That's exactly what happened.
Sure, okay.
So they were supposed to go down to South by Southwest concert down in Texas the next day, and they were given recording time in the recording studio from 11 p.m. to 11 a.m.
Mm.
And so they got in the studio, they blew away this tape, and then they still had some time left in this tape. So they're like, well, what do we fill it with? And they filled it with this and didn't have enough time to do a full version. So they only did a minute 43 seconds of Fight the Power.
Got it. Okay. So.
But it became Love so much that they were asked to come back and do it for Coneheads.
Right. I wonder how, if this was a song, so they had played it live before they put it on the Yellow Tape, right? It's not like they were in the studio and they were like, what song do we all know?
Right.
Okay. Got it. Okay.
So then they came in 1992 to record Gordon with Voivoda.
Mm-hmm.
And they did a full version of Fight the Power. And it was supposed to be the first song recorded, but then they left it off the album.
Mm-hmm.
And then they used that version later on the Coneheads CD.
Right.
Really, really odd way of going about it.
Yeah, very strange. But I think in the end, And on our dumb podcast, after we're done with every album, we resequence it. So like, well, here's what B-sides I would have put on and regular tracks I would have left off. And I believe I still left off Fight the Power. I think it was a good idea for them to leave it off of Gordon.
Odd song for a white band to be singing.
Yes. And this kind of, yes, this is all of my notes is I just keep like every other line when I was listening to the song, I was like, this is baffling. This is tone deaf. This is so weird to me. Like how strange. It's the whole idea of this song subverts the meaning of this song, right? It's about a marginalized group of people like rising up against the forces that keep them down. Except now it's a bunch of white dudes singing about Nutty Buddy bars. Like it just reinforces the struggle. They're like, oh, it's trivialized. Like what? It's a real yucky song.
Well, and I get that Ed's probably, he's like highly influenced by the band, I'm sure.
Sure.
He's also like, probably absolutely loves the song. As we know that the Bare Naked Ladies are a bunch of cause heads. So like, of course they're going to want to do something like this, but the inability to see that it actually back then, I have to say like, I would not have being 5 years younger than them at the time. At that day and age, I would not have recognized how tone deaf that is.
Right.
To be covering that song. Looking back on it with all of my age and wisdom, and I got plenty of it according to my gray hair. there is so much tone deafness to this song.
Sure. And it is.
Keep the words the same, to not change it, to then show support toward the cause rather than being a person living the the struggle.
Yep.
It hurts a little bit to hear it.
Yes, absolutely. That nails it exactly. It is, it's insane to me. And for a while I was like, because before, we sort of got into it, I wasn't sure if there was another version of the song other than the Coneheads version. And even then I was like, 93, it was a different time. They were young. Maybe they didn't get it. Found out about the Yellow Tape version. I was like, okay, they were even younger then, but not totally excusable, but you know, they were dumb kids. But then right before we taped, you sent me a version of them doing this song from 2000 and goddamned 9? Ladies, you have got to understand that that is far beyond the time where you should be doing the song about, you know, how black people, a song with a line like, we're black and proud in it, like... Jesus
well, and black
Christ.
Man, like, and right. Like, we're the black man. I'm like, whoa.
Yes, absolutely. Ew. It made my head spin that they did so many versions of it and never stopped.
I just don't think they stopped to think about it.
Which is nuts, because at some point somebody had to have... I mean, do you fuck with the Bare Naked Ladies? Do you say to them, like, hey, guys, I know you are... multi-platinum, like, a band that has earned their accolades many times over. I mean, you just can't talk to them, right? If they have an idea in their head, are they just going to do it?
Are you saying they're the George Lucas of the music world?
Jesus, I don't want that to be true, but the fact that they fucking did this in 2009, this song really is like the Watto of the Bare Naked Ladies world, right? George Lucas should have known better than to put in a weird Jewish stereotype in his movie.
Sure. Absolutely.
I don't
exactly.
know. It's real fucking weird.
Well, there are other times that we've talked about, and I wish I could think on the top of my head, like right now, like which one it was. But there was an Ed song where, looking back on it and listening to it in today's culture versus 10 years ago,
mm-hmm.
we were like, Ed, like, you can't say that.
Oh, really?
You'll be coming to it, because I want to say it's on Blam.
Okay. Which, again, wasn't...
I wish
that's,
I could remember which that, one it is. Beautiful.
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 What album is that on, out of curiosity?
That is on Everything to... No, Bare Naked Ladies Are Men. I was right
okay.
on one thing. Wow. so, yeah, when you get to Beautiful, I think you'll see what I mean. I don't want to rehash it all, but yeah, it taken from the filter that we ended up taking it from.
Sure.
You sit there and go, oh, Ed, like, that's very, like, demeaning to women. Like, you can't do that.
Yeah. And I mean, at the same time, I think that, I mean, even we've hit stuff where we said, like, you know, it's weird, but it's a choice that they're making. Like in on Stunt, the song Never Is Enough, you know, where Ed's like, clearly it's kind of demeaning towards people with menial jobs. Like, I could do that, but why the fuck would I? Why would I fucking plant trees?
Why would
right?
I want to?
Why would I want to? And there it hurts because it's a choice, but you think, well, maybe he's in character here, right? Because when Steve does songs, I want to believe that he's not the piece of shit that he represents himself to be in a lot of the songs, so you hope that it's a character. But when you cover a song like this, you're not a character. You're covering the song, like, maddening.
He should have... The one time I would have liked to have seen them actually cover this song, though, and I don't think there's any copies of it out there. I don't think there's any way to track it down. But I would like to have seen them cover the song, but change it up and make it applicable for the situation. Would have been their first concert in Toronto after Mayor June Rollins had found their name offensive and refused to let them play the
sure.
the New Year's Eve party.
Yeah.
In Times Square, or not Times Square, in Nathan Phillips Square.
Yeah.
Like, them coming back, and like, that made them big. That's what made them big.
Right.
But them coming back at the next concert after that and doing it there would have just been a great big fuck you to her. Like,
yeah.
That would have been great.
Yeah.
It would have been applicable considering what what the band says that the song is about. So
yeah, yeah. Yeah, and it's, like, I have to admit, too, that, like, Bare Naked Ladies, they were kind of my introduction to, I mean, very light rap, and then I sort of got into it from there, and they sort of introduced me to the Beastie Boys, their cover of Shake Your Rump, which remains,
oh, yeah.
I love that cover so much, it's so playful and fun, and there's such a difference between them covering Beastie Boys, three white dudes rapping about partying, and Public Enemy.
Yes.
You know, so it's just like, you gotta know your audience. You gotta know what the fuck you're doing.
Well, and you could cover Public Enemy, just not this.
Sure. And I mean, it's, I think it might be hard to find a Public Enemy song that is not in some way political or, you know, about the plight of you know, what African-American people are, you know, running into. But yeah, it's still, there's gotta be a better fucking song. I don't know.
Right. Or you could write it from the outside point, rewrite it and do it from the outside point of view of a person that is just supporting.
Sure. Like, but I feel like
just
then,
change it enough.
Yeah. If you're rewriting a song like this, I mean, unless you're writing like an answer song or a reply song, if you're just taking the song and changing it, are you Weird Al-ing this song? Even if it's a serious cover, like, I think you could probably write your own original song that talks about it. You know what I mean? Like, taking their song and
yes.
changing it is, again, taking power away from them in some way, right? Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's true.
So, just weird.
Well, and that was the other thing. I lost my thought for a moment, but now you just, like, brought it back to me. Like, the other thing that makes me really feel weirded out by this song is where the one time they do change the lyrics to the song is about that where they're making a joke.
Elvis was a hero to most, buddy. Elvis was a hero to most, buddy. Ibsen was a hero to most, buddy. Rich was a hero to most, buddy. Hackett was a hero to most. Nutty Buddy was a hero to most, buddy. Never meant shit to me. See,
I know, Nutty Buddy. It made me gasp when I heard it. Jesus.
So like, Public Enemy goes, Elvis was a hero to most, and they repeat it four times.
Yeah.
Bare Naked Ladies does what they did in their early years where they're irreverent and they're just going to have fun with the song, and they change and they play that off what you had said, the word, but I never gave, boy.
Yeah, they say, but he never meant much.
But
or, but he never
and
meant
they change
to,
it to Buddy.
Yeah.
And then Buddy Rich and then Buddy.
Buddy,
you know,
Epstein, Buddy Hackett.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I get you're having fun with it.
Yeah.
I get what you're doing.
Right.
This is not a song that you have fun with that
right.
way. You
right.
know, Michael Jackson told Weird Al that he could not cover and do a parody of Black and White because it was too important a song.
Sure, sure.
I would go so far as to say the same thing here with Bare Naked Ladies. You cannot make jokes in the middle of this song.
Yeah, and
you're
was
either
going
to cover it faithfully or you're not.
I think that maybe it was I think it was Paul McCartney too, which we were going to talk about today, told Weird Al because he was going to do Live and Let Die as Chicken Pot Pie, and
right.
he was like, "I'm a vegetarian. No, you cannot do Chicken Pot Pie." Like, yeah, if you got, oh, go ahead.
I'm not going to sanction anything that involves the killing of animals in order
right.
to make food.
Right. Yeah. And you know, if they have a message, you have to respect that. I wonder, I'm sure there wasn't a conversation between BNL and Public Enemy, but it's just very strange. Very,
yeah.
very weird. And I hate to be, I mean, it's important to be that guy and stand up for stuff, but like, man, you had me on an episode and you had me on Fight the Power, the one where, like, I can't be funny on this one. You gotta be like, Bare Naked Ladies, like, come on, guys. I don't know.
I know. We've had you on Fight the Power and Born Human now.
Yeah, Born Human was okay. That's about a wolf one. It's cool.
Exactly. That one's a little more satirical.
Yeah, yeah. So, but yeah, this one is absolutely bizarre to me. I was listening and I was wondering and I was like, I wonder what 1990s Ed, and we talk about time travel a lot on our podcast, I wonder what 1990s Ed would say if he could look through a portal at 2019 Ed singing shit like You and Me Versus the World, where he's like referencing like MacGyver and Princess Bride, and I wonder if he would be like, what the, you fucking weird old man, like, this is like a boring country, like, I just wonder if he would see him and be like, oh, you've lost your edge, like, I don't
Oh,
I don't
know, because they do that in some of their older songs.
Yeah.
They have that with, oh, what's the other B-side? I can't think of now. Oh, boy.
They always drop references. You're right. But it's just like, I feel like they've gotten soft and doughy around the middle, right? Where they used to be edgy. Oh, Yeah. Sure.
Couldn't care less. Yes. Like, that whole song is just them being, like, dropping references left and right and making jokes on them.
Yeah.
So I'm betting that Ed would be okay with it.
Yeah, but I just wonder about the softness. I just wonder if he would see his future self and wonder where he went, that edgy kid who used to be there.
I'm still hoping to get him on the show, so I'm going to say he would like it.
Oh, you don't want me to ruin your chances of, you don't want to become my podcast where we just insult them the whole time.
That's right. I have I can insult, but then I get a backup.
Hey, Ed, if you're listening to this one, please come on ours as well. We won't hurt you. We can do a big party cast where it's all seven of us or whatever, yeah. But yeah.
I would love that. That would be amazing.
did you understand in the Coneheads version, there's the John Wayne line where originally they say, like, what are they, motherfuck him and John Wayne. In the Bare Naked Ladies one, Steve is not saying motherfuck him and John Wayne. So I went looking for the lyrics and everybody just puts like X's or a blank there. And I can't understand that lyric at all.
Don't get mad, John Wayne!
And I wonder, because that's almost like a linchpin for the song, right? Like, if they said, you know, fuck John Wayne, great. But if they said, like, you know, I'm wearing a banana on my head or made some other goof and then something about John Wayne, then it would have, again, changed the tone of the song a lot.
It's hard to find the Coneheads version anything online. I actually had to buy the song off from iTunes in order to be able to get it.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
And of course, now I've lost it, so. By the time I post this, I'll be like, oh, yeah, here it is.
Right.
I found it underneath all the, like, 10 piles. Oh, there it is. Yeah, I did find it eventually. I just had to find the right spot of my stuff here. I mean, because usually they will put the lyrics.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
In the area of the, you know, the liner notes down below them.
Okay.
Now, of course, I got all these ads, so it's going to take a while for it to load up all the ads. Uh-huh. So I'm looking at this, and while I'm scrolling down through the notes, the first thing that's listed is, this song did not deserve to be turned into a joke.
Oh, really?
So we are not the only one to say this.
Thank God, because it's crazy.
And then so the next person says, what makes you call this a joke?
Uh-huh.
And Jacob Stoller, who made the first statement, said, did you listen to it?
Exactly.
One of the great American anthems of civil rage is reduced to a goofy party song?
Jesus. Yeah, like, right on, dude.
He was a little stronger than I was on that.
Yeah. I do feel like the only person who would be able to defend this is, like, a super BNL stan who's just like, you know, I'm sure they meant well. Like, I don't know. I'm reading the same thing.
The last response, and this is like 12 or 12 of them down. Last one is, fuck you. It's a homage. I'm like, whoa.
Yeah, boy, that's
this escalated quickly.
Sure. Yeah.
But they don't have the lyrics here. So you're right. I don't know what it is that he says at that point in the song.
Don't know. But I wonder, because that I think would change. And it's impossible. There's too much going on in that part of the song to understand it. But I have to admit,
they're busy.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
They're very busy throughout this song. And they're doing what they tended to like to do. They like to throw those little quips in between. And some of that was Flava Flav immediately doing it in the Fight the Power song.
Right.
The original. But Steve does throw a couple of extra little bits in there like he likes to do in the early stuff.
Yeah. And boy, do they sound like they're having fun. I can never say the Bare Naked Ladies don't sound like they're having a good time. Like, this, I love hearing Ed and Steve collab like this, that Fight the Power chant during the chorus that presumably the rest of the band does.
Oh, yeah.
It's a blast. Like, it's a good time. And I, despite myself, like, the piano, the banjo, whatever it is, straight off the bat, is just like, it's good. I love it.
Oh, yeah.
I love it, yeah. So instrumentally, this song gets a thumbs up.
Oh, yeah, they were having a great time. It's a not a great choice.
Yeah, yep, exactly.
The other thing I want to say, so like that, the one that I sent to you just before we started, the one on the Ships and Dips tour.
Right.
Which was done 1 week before Steven left the band.
Right.
Or was kicked out, whichever way you want to look at
mm-hmm.
it. I love this because, one, they are having way so much fun on this.
Yes. Oh, my God. And it's all six of them, which is great. And another drummer. Who is
seven.
That, who is that drummer?
So that is the guy who sets up Tyler's drums. What they'll do sometimes in concerts, I covered this a couple episodes ago, and I don't remember what his name is off the top of my head. He sets up the drums for Tyler and tests them out and everything beforehand. And in the middle of the show, if they need someone to step out and be Santa Claus, or they need to kind of fill in some of the notes, or if they have a certain spot they can't quite fill perfectly and they want that in there, they'll have him come out and fill that in.
I see. Okay. He's the Brian Epstein of the Bare Naked Ladies. He's the...
Yes.
Okay. Got it. All right. The Pete Best. That's the name I was trying to think of.
The Pete Best. Yes. Sure. He's like the Pete Best.
Yeah.
Except Pete Best really was a Beatle.
Right.
Sort of. This guy's never really a B&L, but he's very important to the band. So,
okay.
Yeah. I get the reference.
Yeah. Interesting. Okay. So yeah, it's...
And Steven is so skinny in this video.
He really...
I did not recognize him. I thought it was someone like Boothby Grafo coming out and covering with them. And then I went, oh, wait, no, that's actually Steve.
Yeah.
Oh, Steve, I'm glad you're back to health.
Yeah, he looks perilously thin there.
He was looking bad.
The man who is in charge of that stage is Andy Cregan. Oh, my God. He's having so much fun.
Totally. I was so glad to see Andy back. Anytime Andy comes back on any of the songs, I'm like, oh, why can't you just rejoin them?
Right.
I'll forgive you, little tiny song, if you will please come back and rejoin them.
I did the most pathetic thing that one can do, which is... of course you type in all the Bare Naked Ladies names into Facebook, and he was the only one who came up, so I sent him a friend request that I fully never expect anything to happen, but I dream at night about being friends with Andy.
That would be amazing.
But he does a little solo at the end of the song. He like stands up and just jams on the piano, and he's having a fucking blast. I love it so much.
And it's so funny, like anytime he's playing with him, Steve is always near him. Like, he and Steve still get along so amazingly well.
Yeah,
They recently just did a tour together. Well, not a tour, but they did 5 concerts together, which I wish I had had the money to go to Canada and see.
Oh, wow. That would have been amazing.
Yeah, so Steven was doing his songs along with some Bare Naked Ladies songs, and Andy was... Oh, crap. Now that word's got out of my head. What's going on tonight?
I don't know.
he was running the orchestra.
He was conducting.
Mm. Yes.
Conducting.
He was conducting NWA, the orchestra. NWA. That was Steven.
Okay.
So that was one where I was
interesting.
I wish I'd been there.
Yeah, that sounds real cool.
And I saw it coming from months beforehand. So like every week I would send an email to both Andy and the orchestra and to Steve saying, can you please put this online? Can you please put it live?
And you guys are good friends with Steve now, right? As he was on your cast.
I wish we were good friends with him. We got to interview
him. And you have his personal phone number. You're BFFs.
I do have his personal phone number. I should go back and call him, but I don't.
100% you should.
I should. Well, I shouldn't, but I'm so tempted to.
How much do I have to pay you for us to have a very special episode of It's All Been Done where we prank call Stephen Bates?
Oh, don't tempt me. Oh, my goodness.
Just kidding, Steve. Come on our podcast. I love you.
Steve would think that was hilarious, I think.
Oh, I don't know about that, but hopefully.
Oh, he's got a great sense of humor. I want to get back to real quickly... What do you give this for a rating? So we do ratings different on our show.
Yeah.
But I'd love to hear your normal rating that you usually give it, and then we can put a number to it as well, 0 to 5,
sure.
Of how many. We can start with 0 to 5 if it makes you feel better about it.
Why don't you go first with your 0 to 5?
0 to 5. How many Spike Lees
got it.
Do you give this song?
Sure. I would say on a scale of 0 to 5, it's hard because it's indisputably a good song. It's a good song that's done well by them. I do not in any way begrudge them their musical talent. Everybody's killing it. Jim is killing it. Ty is killing it. Ed's rap sounds wonderful. Clearly this was, he was born into rap and he loves it, but they just shouldn't fucking do this. So I'm going to give it a -5.
Wow.
Can I do that? So it's a 5 out of 5. It's a 5 out of 5, but it's negative. You should not be doing this.
I don't know what this is going to do to the mic, to the software.
Oh, do you actually keep track of all these?
I do. I keep track of all of them.
Uh-oh. Sorry, dude.
I'm going to be doing some wonderful numbers, crunching numbers at the end of all this. But I think I've now officially broken the system.
I can give it a real rating.
It's looking at me with a blank screen.
Okay. Should I go a different rating? I can just give it like a 2. Oh, okay, fine.
No,
negative 5 it is.
Okay, good. It's working now.
God, this is my secret plan for the downfall of your podcast.
That's right. Just come back on anytime and give us negatives.
Yes, exactly. Should have given it an imaginary number. Oh, well.
So I love the song. I love listening to it. It's fun. Once again, all the things we've said up until now, the only thing that would make this even more cringeworthy is if they were doing it in blackface. Like, That would take it to the whole next level.
Mm-hmm.
This is about as far as you can go into a cultural appropriation without doing blackface.
Yeah.
That being said, if I close my eyes and forget it's Bare Naked Ladies and just enjoy the music, I have to give it a 3.
Sure.
So that's where I'm going to go with it. I'm going to give it a 3, but with the asterisk of like, yeah, but we got to remember this is Bare Naked Ladies and not sure. Public Enemy.
Yes, yeah, totally.
So that brings us to an average, because the other people will be adding theirs in later.
Okay.
That brings us to an average of -1. I think that's easily going to go down as the lowest scored Bare Naked Ladies song ever.
No.
That's saying a lot. I mean, that puts it below Vegetable Town.
Oh, boy. Okay, I'm so sorry. I apologize.
No, I mean, there's a good reason for that, so...
Yeah, okay.
It's a
I did
story.
Give it a 5, yeah.
So, what would you give it for your rating, since you guys won't be covering this?
Sure, I think you hit the nail on the head. The year is 2003. You are a young Saker, and you are attending OhioCon 2003, Ohio's premier anime convention, and you have your cosplay already. You are cosplaying as your favorite character from Super Smash Brothers Melee, which just came out the year beforehand. So you're in your hotel room and you're putting all of your makeup on and the outfit, and when you're all done, you look in the mirror and you realize that you are wearing, of course, a black Zentai bodysuit, which is head-to-toe spandex bodysuit. You're wearing a balaclava, black balaclava, and you have painted the parts of your face that are not covered by the balaclava with black face paint, because you are, of course, going as Mr. Game & Watch, your favorite character from Super Smash Bros. Melee.
Of course.
And when you look in that mirror, you realize, I cannot go out in public like this. People who do not know what is going on will kill me. They will shoot me. I will be hurt badly. And for good reason. Because it very much appears that I am going outside in blackface.
Yeah.
So for that matter, this song is 2003 Saker at an anime convention in unintentional blackface. Just like the Bare Naked Ladies are today.
I
in
love
2009!
It.
They did it after I did it! I was 16 years old and I had the good sense to not go out of my hotel room like that.
Exactly. And they have 10 years on you. Like, come on, guys.
Yeah. Dummies. Oh, well. They're wonderful anyway.
They live the rich life, so.
I get it. Ships and dip, you have to deep dive. You're doing songs you vowed you would never do because you have 400 concerts on a boat. Like, yeah, I get it, but come on.
That's the one out of the whole catalog you avoid.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But there you go.
I love it. That's a great rating. So here's what I had thought of. I love community theater. And sometimes community theater can be almost as good, or maybe even better than, Broadway shows. And I love the show Full Monty. It is a great variation on the movie, and it's an amazing story, and perfect for community theater, given the plot. This song reminds me very much of the Full Monty, as it is a variation on an original. And it can be great. So, here's the scenario. I go to see the Full Monty at a local community theater. And I'm very excited and enjoying it until halfway through they introduce Haas, Horse, the African-American character. And it is a man doing it in blackface. The actor is hitting all the lines, but I just can't get over the cringeworthiness of it. And the whole show just feels like
Scrubs!
I know how this show is supposed to end. The production that I was in had the actors remove their hats from their genitals just as the lights dropped quickly. And you know they are fully nude. But I just can't stick around that long because I feel like someone is hitting me with a big-ass rock. So I never get to truly fully enjoy the Full Monty and the final moments where it's bare naked. And instead, I just get to know that at some point it will be bare naked because of the unintentional racism. That is my take.
Hey guys, this is Michelle, and I'm here with my thoughts on Fight the Power, the Bare Naked Ladies cover of it. I listened to the Yellow Tape version, and I listened to the Conehead version, and I listened to the live version of them on the Live from Toronto. And I have to say, the Yellow Tape is my favorite version, but I think that's because it reminds me of them doing it live on the WCLZ patio concerts. I think that they did that because I remember hearing it on the radio, the live version, and thinking, oh my God. And it surprised me. But this is when I was first kind of getting into the Bare Naked Ladies, and I heard them do that, and I was like, huh, that's interesting. I know the Yellow Tape version came out in 91, but I wasn't listening to them at that time. And Tracy, you'll have to correct me if I'm wrong. I might be, but I'm pretty darn sure that they did Fight the Power on the CLZ concert somewhere. I have no idea where, but in a box somewhere, I have got a cassette tape recording of the CLZ concert that I taped off the radio with my boombox. Yes, people, that's right. I said cassette tape, boombox, and recording. But I have to say, I like the song a lot. I like their version of it. The Coneheads version is more polished, but to me, the essence of the song, I want to hear them do it live. I want to hear them going back and forth, you know, totally off the chain. Who knows what they're going to say? Who knows what is going to happen between Ed and Steve? But again, this is one of those songs where it really highlights their how good they are riffing off of each other and getting ideas from each other. And that's why I like the live version of it. So it's a great song. I mean, and we need it more today than ever. But having said that, I'm going to give it a 4 just because, well, I don't know how to, I feel like because it's a cover, I feel like, I don't know how to rate it. I almost want to give it a 4.5, just because it's awesome, but that's for the Yellow Tape version. I have to consider all the versions and give it, I'm going to stick with my original score and that's a 4. It's damn good. But I want the live version. Okay. I hope you guys are having a great time, and we'll talk to you soon.
By the way, thanks a lot for introducing me to Hello from the Magic Tavern.
Oh, you're quite welcome. It's a great show, right?
It's a great show. That's an earworm that has dug its way all the way to my brain.
Oh, yes. It is. It's wonderful. And we were lucky enough to just have Tim Sniffen on our Never Do Anything episode, the voice of the mysterious man. He was so good.
I know. I was just starting to break away and be like, okay, I can put this away for a little while. I've listened. Yeah. I listened to like 130 episodes. And then Tim came on. No, I got to go back and listen to more episodes. Just when I was ready to get it to put it away. There are almost 200 episodes at this point.
Yeah, for sure. They've been on hiatus for the last couple months between seasons 2 and 3, but they're coming back, I believe, July 22nd, and I'm here for it. I'm psyched.
Oh, I wish I could be there. That sounds wonderful.
Yeah.
Do you know how hard it is to catch up on 200 episodes, though?
Oh, truly, I cannot. I listen to too many. I listen to 12 podcasts a week, which is too many podcasts, and I can't catch up with what I have in my backlog on iTunes. So, no, I get you.
No, I'm giving up. I'm waving the white flag.
Yeah, for sure, yeah.
And speaking of white flags...
No worries.
I think we should call a truce on any animosity between our podcasts, if there ever is.
I get. All right, fine. Fine, the hatchet is buried.
You guys are totally different. Like you guys come at it in a different direction.
It's true. Yeah, if people, I don't think that any Bare Naked Ladies fans like our podcast, which is fine with me. That's not what we're here for.
I would disagree. It's okay. I've read the iTunes reviews. There are a lot of BNL fans that love you guys.
I go to sleep at night, and the names Jorky and Bubba Hotep just, they're in my brain, and they don't go away.
I was just going to tell you, so we're two completely different. There's, there's your way of attacking BNL songs, there's our way of attacking them and loving them.
Right.
And for some reason, Jorky and Bubba Hotep need to start their own, because... they don't like either of us.
Sure. Yes, absolutely. Which is very, very funny to me. But no, we don't care. We read the ones that reviews on the podcast. I actually very much enjoy them. So it's all good. They don't hurt me at all. I'm not upset. It's fine. You don't even care.
They were our first review, and our Jerkies was, and it dug. And then I'm like,
You have a thicker skin than me, my friend. I would have stopped the podcast and deleted every episode from the from the internet.
I will tell you, I was tempted, and then my fellow podcasters told me, "What are you doing? No, you love this. No, we're not letting you." Of course, now where are they?
Right, exactly.
Thanks a lot, guys. So, what were we talking about? I saw Dave Matthews Band a couple weeks ago with my wife.
Oh, yeah? Okay, how was that?
Dave Matthews Band fan.
Yeah.
I have to say that even though Boyd isn't there, sorry, Boyd, make better choices in your life, they found a great way to cover his space, with the horns and the keys and Tim on the guitar. They rocked it out. And one of my favorites of theirs is Ants Marching. And they were just, on that spot where they normally rock it, live, mm-hmm. and he is just I swear he must go through five fiddles during that song.
Right.
You didn't miss him. They covered him so incredibly well.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Oh, very cool. That's cool to hear.
So, how did I get the ants? Ants, black flag. You kill ants with black flag. Yeah.
Wait, okay.
Why was I talking about
black flag? Listen, you're in IABD territory now where we have no idea what we're talking about at any time.
I don't know. Anyways, next week we're talking about the song The Flag. So, we'll get to it.
There goes
maybe
the
by
river.
Then I'll remember it.
Right.
So, anyways, I have really, truly loved having you on today, Saker. I do hope you come back for another B-side at some point in the future.
Anytime, my friend, anytime.
Anytime that you want me on, feel free. We would love to cross over anytime, because you guys have a great time over on your podcast as well.
We do. We have a lot of fun. So, yeah, come listen to us. It's all Been Done American Ladies Podcast, and we're at Been Done Pod on Twitter.
Please go listen to them.
Yeah. Thank you for having me. Yeah, we'll have you on sometime. I'm excited
for
that. Yeah,
definitely. Well, thank you very much. Cool. That was fun.
Thanks, that was fun. Don't forget, no regrets, except maybe one.
We need to put this behind us and work together to get Steven and BNL back together again.
At least if the Bare Naked Ladies are done, then we don't have to continue to discuss every single song.
Shut up, Saker. If there is no Bare Naked Ladies, then I'll never get to fight you again.
What?
You're the reason I stay up until 2 a.m. editing every single episode until I feel absolutely sick.
You know, you could just edit it the next day.
You're the reason why I listen to another postcard 27 times in a week. You're the reason I get up at 4:30 in the morning to post this week's podcast episode. You're the reason that my children cry, "Daddy, please change the song," on the way to soccer and track practices. And if it wasn't for you, I would have never learned how deeply my friends love Bare Naked Ladies. So if you help me save the Bare Naked Ladies, make their music what it used to be, we will have something to quibble over. You will be my greatest nemesis. You will save us.
You just said us.
Yeah. Bare Naked ABCs. And it's all been done.
How about it's all been done in Bare Naked ABCs?
Done. And done again.
Like, as in, it's all been done?
I see what you did there.
Hey, I'll help you save Bare Naked Ladies. Now let's go ruin Evan and Aaron's podcast.
To celebrate joining Pantheon Podcasts, Rock Camp, the podcast, the official podcast of Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, is giving away a guitar signed by Mike Portnoy of Dream Theater, Marty Friedman, formerly of Megadeth, and legendary shredder Zakk Wylde, plus our rock star counselors like Vinny Appice, Monty Pittman, and more. To enter to win, simply follow, rate, and review our podcast on your preferred platform, and that's all you have to do. For more information, go to rockcamp.com/podcast.